Hey guys, this video is going to be a full introduction to Figma. It's going to be a very long one, and it's just an extract from one of the courses which I'm preparing on Udemy. So if you're interested in that, feel free to check it out. But without further ado, let's jump into the video. So as you can see, the first thing which you're going to be able to view is the recently viewed files. Now, once you add a few files, you're going to see them all here. And you're eventually going to be able to scroll through the files, since once you have many of them, you're going to be able to view them all in this area. Now, a cool feature is that you can also see the files as a list view. So as you can see, you can also browse through the last viewed, and you can basically change the way that you see the files. Now, you can also import a Figma file which has the extension .fig directly from here, or you can create a new file by simply clicking on the plus. Now, there's some other options and things to consider in this dashboard. The first one being is the search feature. So if you want to search for a specific file, you can do it directly by directly here. So you can simply start typing, and the results are going to appear automatically based on what you typed. Now, another interesting feature is the notification bell. And this is going to be very important, especially when you're working with clients and the clients are going to leave comments into the Figma files, because this notification bell is going to enable you to see things like when clients noted comments, reply to comments, or shared files with you, and you can accept or decline the new files which you receive, and there's a whole sort of options which are going to be very, very useful, and I almost check it daily, so it's definitely something to keep in mind. Now, we also have the plugins, which is going to be a topic for an entire video, because plugins are amazing and enables us to create, to streamline our workflows in all sorts of ways, but we're going to focus on them in a moment. And we also have the drafts. So if you created a draft, you're probably going to be to see it over here. Now, we're also going to discuss Teams, but just to give you an overview, basically Teams allow you to work with, to create different set of teams inside your main Figma dashboard. So even if you're working with multiple teams, multiple clients, you're going to be able to manage the projects very easily and very efficiently directly from this panel over here. Now, there's also an upgrade option which enables you to basically collaborate with more teammates, and we're also going to explore that later on. Now, also another thing which is important to consider is that we have the help and resources available over here. So if you need any things like the help center, the community forum, video tutorials, reset the onboarding, and also some notes and legal summary, you can basically access all of these items directly from here. So this can be quite handy. Now, this is pretty much it for the overview. Next video, we're going to jump into a file and start learning how to work with design files in Figma. Now, let's create our first Figma file. So as you can see, I'm in the main dashboard, and I'm going to click on the very top right element, this plus icon, which is the new file. Now, as you can see, now the file is loading up, and we are in our first Figma file. So as you can see, the default title is untitled, but if you simply click on it, you can title it to whatever type you want. So just gonna rename it to designer. And as you can see on the very left, we have this layers and assets panel, and also the page. Now, we're going to start with the page. So we're just going to click on it. And as you can see, we are on page one. Now, pages are very useful. And by the way, you can scroll down this, so you're going to have more space for more pages. And pages basically allow you to organize multiple screens and multiple parts of the projects in organized sort of folders. You can see pages as folders, and the content inside of it is going to be the actual documents and files. So we can create two pages, and if, for example, we add a rectangle by simply clicking over here, and I'm just going to click and hold and drag it. And as you can see, we created our first rectangle. Now, one thing that you might have seen is that on the left, we have this new rectangle one layer, and this is basically the layers panel. So these are very important concepts to keep in mind, and you're going to work with pages and layers all of the time. So essentially, pages or your folders again, and rectangle in this case is the actual file element. And I can also go ahead and, for example, create a star over here, and we can change the color. And as you can see, we have this other element. Now, if I click and move the star and I put it below by simply clicking and holding with the left mouse button, and I put it below, you can see that layers are actually in order of hierarchy. So if rectangle one is above star one, you're going to be able to see the rectangle first, while the star is going to be beneath it. Now, all of this happened in page two, but if you click on page one, as you can see, everything disappeared. But don't worry, because it really hasn't. We just changed the page where we're at. And if we go back to page two by simply clicking on it, you're going to be able to see these elements again. Now, in order to make this concept even more clear, I'm going to create a polygon over here. I'm just going to click and hold and drag it with the shift key. And basically, as you can see, we have this triangle. Now, if I go to page two, we're going to see again our rectangle and our star. By the way, I just deleted the rectangle by clicking on the return key on the keyboard. So as you can see, these are the first things which I wanted to basically explain. So pages, layers, how they work essentially, and how to create a new file, because these are going to be things that you're going to use all the time. Now, in the next lesson, we're going to move forward. So we're going to discuss about artboards. So that's going to happen in just a moment. After discussing pages and layers, now I want to talk about frames. Now, frames are going to be a very important element which you're going to use all of the time in your design journey. And you can see it on the very top left, this icon right here with these four intersecting lines. And basically, if you click on the arrow, you're going to see that frame is selected. And I can simply click on this icon right here. And as you can see, I have some options on the right. Now, I can choose between some presets for example, iPhone 8 sizes. And if I click on iPhone 8, as you can see, now I have this rectangle, which isn't quite just a rectangle. This is basically a container of a screen. So let's say that we're working on a few screens for a mobile iPhone app. The elements are going to be contained in a artboard. So, for example, let's add a star right here, and I'm going to click and drag with shift, and I'm going to change the color of the star to this green. Now, as you can see, since I created the star inside the artboard while it was selected, the star is inside, so it's basically below iPhone 8 one. So if I actually take the star and I move it outside, you can see as on the left, the star now it's outside of the artboard. But if I click and hold and drag it, I can see that the artboard has now this light blue outline. And basically, this is Figma telling me that if I release the drag, the star is going to be inside of the iPhone artboard. And further confirmation of this, you can see it on the very left, since the star is now temporarily below the artboard. So basically, this is telling me that the star is inside. Now, if I release, you can see that the star is inside. And if I move it on the right, you can see how the star is not going outside of the artboard. Because if we just had a rectangle, the star could easily go outside. But in this case, since it's an artboard, it basically will stay within the boundaries of that specific artboard. And again, if I just click on frame again, I can literally have a look at different frame artboards. So basically, I can go through tablet, through desktop, even Apple Watches and paper. So these are really useful. However, sometimes you want, or actually most of the times, you might have a specific requirement from a developer, or maybe you want a specific dimension that you want to choose and tweak. Well, the easiest way to do that is to simply select the frame again, and you can draw on the main file. And as you can see, we have these options on the very right. The first one is width, and this is telling me that we're having a frame of 536 pixels, and the height is of 564 pixels. So if I wanted to increase that, I can simply type in, for example, 600, and I can type in again 600. Now we have a frame which is a perfect square. Now, another cool feature that we can use is to simply go on the W or the H letter, and I can literally click, and while holding the with the left mouse button, I can simply update it directly. So as you can see, I can move around and really change the sizing to whatever I want in a very fast and efficient way. Now, another cool thing about Figma is that I can also use some math, and I can, for example, click on a plus 500 and click on enter. And as you can see, math just happens. So if I do minus 500, now it's 563. So you can use all of these tricks. One that I use all of the time is using the slash, and then I can use the divisions. So basically, if I do slash 2 and I click on enter, I can divide the current number by 2. So these are quite useful, and we're going to use these options throughout the course. But yeah, this is definitely something to keep in mind. And normally, when you're using Figma, you're going to be able to have design files with many, many different frames. I've been working on projects with hundreds and upon hundreds of frames. And Figma allows you to basically organize them in a very easy and fast way. For example, you can click on the frame, and once you have it selected, you can click and move it around with the left mouse button. So this is definitely something which is really useful, and we're also going to explore some more alignment and distribution options later in the course. But for now, I think cover pretty much all the essentials when it comes to frames. So yeah, feel free to have a look around your Figma file, start creating some frames, start playing around with pages and layers, because it's very important for you to learn all of the elements which I'm teaching in this course. While it's very important to actually practice, so feel free to do that, and I'll see you in the next video. This video, I want to talk about the very top header in Figma, since we already explored some of the options that we have over here, but there's some things that we must discuss. So as you can see, if we go and see this area right here, which is the design tab, it's the same name as we have over here, and that's basically telling us the file name. And the great thing about Figma is that we can have multiple design projects all right here on the top bar. And I can also go back to the main Figma dashboard by clicking on the Figma logo. And as you can see, I can have access to all of the design files. And if, for example, I double click on this design file right here, you can see that a new tab is opening at the very top. And I can quickly just browse through the design files by simply clicking on them. And I can also click and keeping hold, I can move them around, so I can reorder multiple design files at once. Now, there's also some other things I want to consider. There's especially the menu. So the top menu, the really cool thing about the top menu is that there is this search functionality. So if you forget how to get somewhere in Figma, but you already know the name more or less of what you're searching for, you can simply search directly from here, and you're going to see all sorts of different results based on the letters which you typed in. So this is quite useful. Now, another thing which I want to go over in this video is the file menu. Now, in the file menu, you can create a new file. You can also import a sketch file. So if you already have a sketch file, you can import it in Figma pretty easily. You can also place the image. And by the way, if you have a look on the right, you can see that for some of these, there's also some keyboard shortcuts. So this is really handy and can really be useful in saving time. You can also save the file as a .fig, which is the Figma extension. So if you want to save a file locally from Figma, you can do that directly from here. You can also pass it to a colleague, and he can open the Figma file without the need of a link. There's also the version history. There's this option to save to version history, because Figma already has some version history depending on the plan you have. The thing on the free one is 30 days, and you can see it directly from here. So if you click on one of these previous design files, it's basically going to say to bring you back to that version, and here it's showing the time when it actually selected that version. So we're going to go back to the current version, and if you have selected an element or an artboard, you can also export it directly from here, and you can export the frames to PDF, which can be quite useful. Now, here we have all sorts of different other options, which for the most part, the names are pretty straightforward, but we're going to work and basically learn about these in other ways, because there's different ways in order to access these options. So we're probably going to spend more time in the future videos with a more practical approach when it comes to these options. We also have the plugins, the integrations, some preferences, which by the way I always keep on default, but feel free to choose them to uncheck some of these or check the ones you like the most. We also have the libraries and the account and the help section right here. But for the most part, I always use this top menu just for the file sections, because the other options are usually easier to just use in other ways. So this is pretty much it for this overview of the top section. We're also going to discuss these right elements in just a bit. And yeah, I'll see you in the next video. Talk about how to create shapes in Figma. In one of the previous videos, you already saw this tool over here, which is the shape tool. And if you click on the arrow, you can see that we can create all sorts of different shapes. The first one is the most classic, which is the rectangle. Now, as you can see, as I click and drag, I'm going to basically be able to create a rectangle. But if I click and hold also the shift key, by clicking and holding the shift key, I can create basically a square. So the ratios are going to pretty much stay the same. And the same is pretty much true for all the other elements. So if I want to create a star, and I click and hold, as you can see, it's kind of like deforming. So, but the moment when I click and hold also the shift key, the ratio is going to be preserved. So this is something to keep in mind. And at the moment we have rectangles, we have lines we can create. We also have arrows, and one of the tricky thing about arrows is that at the beginning you're not going to see it almost, because it's so small. But if you select it and you increase the stroke, you can see that the arrow is going to become more visible, at least the end. Now, another important thing about the arrows is that you can change things like the stroke options over here, and also some other options, but we're going to discuss that in just a moment. We also have the option to have ellipses, and again, if you want a circle, just hit shift and there you go. And we can also place an image. So if I click on a place image, and this is basically going to redirect me to the file folder. So basically I can select an image, upload it, and there we go. So I'll just do that with this image right here, and I'm going to simply place it. Oops, for some reason the image is very big, so as you can see I would need to scale it down, and by hitting shift and just selecting one of these corner elements, I can make it smaller and basically move it around and whatnot. So this is pretty much it when it comes to the basic shapes. Another thing that we're going to discuss is the drawing tools. So we have two drawing tools. The first one is the pen tool, and as you can see, I can literally like click and create either lines or like either straight lines or curved ones by simply moving the pen tool around. And when I'm done with this, I can simply click on the done button, and as you can see, I have my new vector line. And another thing I can do is use the pencil tool, which is basically allowing me to use the pencil. And as you can see also, it's smoothed out the edges. So basically I can have a smoothed out version. We're going to discuss these vector tools more in depth in the future for sure. But I just wanted to give you a brief overview in this video. Now, if I click over here, I can also access the hand tool, which is something that I have access all the time by simply clicking on the space bar, and I can move and pan around the Figma file. So this is really useful, and it's something that you're going to use all the time. So yeah, that's pretty much it for this video. See you in the next one. In this video, we'll discuss how to move around the Figma. So in order to move and have some reference points, we're going to create two rectangles, and I'm simply going to click over here on this icon, and I'm going to create one rectangle, click again on this icon, and create another one. Now, one of the things that you're going to use all the time is this hand tool right here. Now, there's multiple ways you can use it. First one is you can click on it, and if you click and move around the mouse, you can see that you're now going to pan around the design file. Now, if I click on the move tool again, and I click on and hold spacebar, you can see that the hand tool appears again, and I can simply click and pan around. And this is the way that I prefer the most to use the handle. I simply use spacebar, or even better, if you have a touch bar, an Apple touch bar, or if you're in using a MacBook or any other or a PC with a touch bar, you can simply use two fingers to literally move around. I'm using a MacBook Pro at the moment, and this is basically allowing me to just pan around in a very easy way. Another way you can do that is by using a Apple Magic Mouse, or even a regular mouse with a scrolling wheel or something similar is going to work just fine. Just consider that you're not going to be able to browse through the y-axis, but you're only going to be able to use the x-axis, or actually the opposite. So basically you're going to be able to use only the y-axis, but you won't be able to go left and right. But that's not an issue at all, because you can simply click on spacebar or use the hand tool, and you're going to have the exact same freedom to browse through the design file. So this is pretty much it. One last thing that I want to mention is how you can zoom in. So by clicking on the plus key, you can zoom in. And as you can see, as I zoom in a lot, I'm going to be able to see the pixels if I have that option selected, but usually it is by default. And if I click on the minus, you're going to be able to go back and zoom out. And as you can see on the very top right, you have these options as well, and you can see the different options and the different keyboard shortcuts directly from here. So if you're ever wondering what was the keyboard shortcut again, you can simply go here and you'll be able to see all of these options. And also one last thing, if you're using a touch bar again, you can use command and just zoom in and zoom out with your two fingers. So this is pretty much it. So as you can see, there's multiple ways to move around in Figma, and it's pretty intuitive, pretty straightforward, and allows you all of the freedom to focus on the creative process in a very easy and straightforward way. In this video, we're going to talk about comments. Now, comments in Figma are really, really useful to collaborate and to receive feedback and manage feedback from clients. So the way comments work is you simply see and click on this comments icon right on the top bar, and you're going to see that we have a few comments. Now we have comment 1, 2 and comment 3, but there could be more in a document. So, you know, we could have a comment here, for example, and the way that I create a new comment, as you can see, is while I have the comment view selected, I can simply click anywhere on the design file and I can leave a comment directly here. So I'm just going to leave a comment, click on post. And the great thing is that basically whoever is linked to this Figma design file is going to receive a notification, especially if you leave a at direct. So basically if you click on at, you can see that at the moment, I am seeing the option to select myself. Now, the great thing is that if you shared this Figma file with other individuals, other team members, you're going to see all of them right here. So you can potentially tag multiple people in the organization, and they're going to receive an email notification directly if you mention them. So I'm just going to select myself, and I can write any comment and I can post it. And yeah, it's pretty useful. It's way, way better and more organized than going through emails or maybe messages on, you know, Facebook, WhatsApp, things of that nature. It really helps you to organize the workflow and make everything easier. So the way you usually work with clients is you would share the Figma link with them, and we're going to go through the share options in just a moment. But basically, once they're in the Figma design file, they can simply click anywhere You simply have to tell them that they can click here, click anywhere, and they can leave a comment. And the great thing about the comment is that you also have and see all of them directly from this section on the right. So as you can see, I have all of the comments organized and I can click on them and it's going to redirect me exactly on the part of the screen where the comment is. So this is pretty useful. It also tells me useful information such as who made the comment, what is the comment, how long ago was the comment made. And for example, we have only comments from today, but if you have comments from even months ago, we're going to be able to see the dates of those comments. So this is really useful information. I can also click on the top right section and I can also filter to see only my comment, all comments, or show resolved comments, which are essentially comments which already has been solved. And over here I can also basically set the notification. So this is really important because it's basically saying select which comment threads on this file you receive emails and notifications for. So if you select all comments or if you select only yours or none, this is going to have an impact on the notifications that you and your client are going to receive when it comes to the commenting. So I usually have it set up to all comments by default, just to be sure that I receive all the notifications, and I highly recommend you to do the same. So I wouldn't touch that the setting, since it's like this by default. So this is it. That's pretty much it when it comes to comments, and I'll see you in the next video. This video, we're going to talk about the sharing options, which is one of the reasons why I love Figma so much, because it's so easy to share documents and design files, even with people who don't have Figma, they don't have the software installed in their computer, because they can open it directly from the browser. Now, in order to share a Figma file with someone, you simply have to click on the top right share button. And as you can see, we're basically redirected to this model with a few options. So the first thing that you want to consider is the invite section. So basically, if I enter a email, so, you know, sample@email.com, I have the option to allow this user, this which is going to receive the Figma file via email, to either view or edit. Now the difference between this is that if you give them edit, basically they can edit the file, so they have the same options and abilities as you have. If you just give them a view option, they cannot change things like, you know, the typography. They cannot move elements around, so they can only view it as a view only, a read only document. So once you select the options related to that, you can simply click on send invite. Now another great thing about Figma is that I can send someone the link directly. And if you see over here, I actually have an option, anyone with the link or only people invited to this file. So basically, I can send the link only to people with the files, or I can send a link to anyone. So even if I didn't add their email, they can still view the file with the link. So this is really useful if you want to share a link in a more informal way. And again, you can select if they can edit or they can view. And essentially, in order to access this link, you can simply click on a copy link, and you're going to be able to send them this link, which you know, they can have access to either view or edit the Figma file. Now you can also use the embed code, and this basically allows you to embed the Figma file inside a web page. So it's almost like one of those Google Maps integrations where you see the portion of the map, but it's still interactive, so you can still move things around and, you know, view the file This can be useful in some scenarios, but you 99% of the time you're not going to use it unless you're doing you're maybe like sharing a Figma file in an open source way, or maybe you're doing a tutorial in a blog post. So yeah, this is pretty much it when it comes to the sharing options in Figma. Here we're going to talk about how to group layers and some layer options which we have available. So the first thing that we're going to create is two rectangles in order to show these options. And I'm going to give this rectangle a color of green, and the second rectangle, which I'm going to copy by simply clicking on Command plus C and then Command plus V. In Windows, that's Control C and Control V. So we're going to change the color of this one right here. So let's just move it over here. So as we mentioned previously, basically the layer which is on top on the layer view on the left is going to have the top visual hierarchy. So if we move it below, for example, we can see that the green rectangle is now above the blue one. And if you move it back up, this is going to change. Now, another cool thing about layers is that if you're working with, let's say, an element or a page with a lot of different layers, which is quite common if you're going to work on web apps and mobile apps and even websites, you want to group them together in order to have the ability to just have one single element. So the way you do it, there's a few ways. So the first one is you can select one layer and then hold the shift key and select also the other one. And now what you're going to do is you can either click on Command plus G, or you can use the right mouse key and you can click on group selection. Now, as you can see, again, all of these keyboard shortcuts are going to be over here. So don't worry about that. It's all pretty straightforward. And if I click on group selection, now we see that the two layers have disappeared on the layer panel. Well, that's not quite true, because they're still available if we click on this small arrow. And as you can see, we have rectangle 2 and rectangle 1, and they are all contained inside this single group. So the cool thing about groups is that now out of this section, I can click on any one of these two elements, and I'm going to select two of them, and I can move the group around. So it can be really useful. So you can select basically multiple elements at once. And a shortcut in order to select just one element is you can keep pressed Command or Control if you're on a Windows, and you can deep select. And basically this allows you to select elements within, so inside a group, even though there are they're actually grouped all together. So you can deep select, for example, rectangle 1 by holding clicking on a Command, and I can do the same with rectangle 2. So this is really useful. And another thing which is quite useful when it comes to groups is that you can, or layers in general, so this is available for both layers and groups, is the fact that you can lock a layer. So as you can see, I just clicked on this lock icon, and now the group, the entire group is locked. And that means that I cannot select it. And basically the way that I unlock them is I click on the lock again. Now, sometimes you might have many, many layers here and groups, maybe it's hundreds of them, so you're not going to be able to see the lock icon. Now, the easiest way to simply select a locked layer is to basically right click, or actually go ahead here, select layer, and you're going to see the layer or the group which is selected beneath this selection. So I can ungroup them. I can also hide a layer And as you can see, the icon changes from an eye to a closed eye, and I can click again in order to view it. Now, this is useful in some cases, but chances are you're not going to use it all that much. But yeah, that's definitely an option which you have available in your toolset. So this is pretty much it for when it comes to layers, grouping, and the associated options like lock, the view, and I'll see you in the next video. Video, we're going to talk about the alignment options. Now, alignment options are really useful in Figma, and you're going to use them all the time in your projects. Now, the alignment options, you can find them by selecting either one element or a group of elements, and these are going to be on the top right of the menu bar. And as you can see, we have a few options. Now, the very first one is align left. And as you can see, we're basically aligning according to the left side of this group. If I click on align center, the axis is going to move right in the center. And if I go and click on align right, the axis is going to move on the right. Now, we can also do this on a vertical fashion. So if we just select all of these elements and we use the rotation tool in order to rotate them, and we make them vertical, you can see that if I click on align vertical centers, the elements are going to align on the, instead of the Y axis, on the X axis. So basically we're going the other way. And the same is true if you go and click on align top or align bottom. It's going to basically move the axis either on the bottom or on the top, as we just saw just a moment ago. So one more thing that I want to mention regarding the alignment options is something which is really useful that I use all of the time in Figma. And those are the distribution options. So let's say that we have a few of these elements. And I'm, by the way, I'm duplicating them by clicking and selecting the Alt button. And as you can see, I have two cursors, and I can basically move the element around and create a copy instantly. Now, that being said, I want to show you the distribution option. So let's say that we want to align vertically these, and now we want to have equal spacing between one of these elements and the other. Well, it's very easy. You can simply go over here, click on distribute horizontal spacing, and now we're having equal spacing between one element and the other. And we can also use these useful basically handles in order to create more or less space in between. And these are available once we have equal spacing between the elements. Now, the same is true also vertically. So if we just move this like this around and we give them different spacing, we can simply select all of these squares and use distribute vertical spacing. And as you can see, now we have equal spacing between these squares. Now, there's also the tidy up and option, but these are usually the ones which I use all the time. I encourage you to do the same, because you can use them for all sorts of elements. You can use it with typography. It doesn't necessarily need to be an element, a shape. You can use them with images, so there's a lot of flexibility when it comes to these options. And as time goes on, you're going to find yourself using them more and more, because you're going to spot the patterns and really see the use and how useful and how much time these can help you save. So this is it for this video. See you in the next one. In this video, I'm going to show you how to scale elements, change their sizes, and also edit them. Now, there's a few things to consider. The first one is that if you want to scale an element, one of the easiest way is to simply press K, and you're going to go on the scale tool. And this allows you to easily scale an element up or down. And as you can see, the value on the right is going to update automatically. So this is the first way you can scale an element. The other way is you can simply go directly here and change the number exactly to the value which you want. So if I want the square to be 400 pixels, I can simply go over here and select it and type in 400, and it's going to be 400 pixels. Now, if I click over here, it's going to constrain the proportions. Now, if I uncheck that, this square is now going to potentially be a rectangle if I change the value. So as you can see, I can easily just move around. And by the way, I just selected this cell. I kept pressing shift, and then I used the up and down arrows in the keyboard in order to change the size of this rectangle. Now, if I want to change the major vector points, I can simply double click on this rectangle. And as you can see, now I have these circles around the major points in the rectangle. And I can select them and I can move around and basically create a different shape. Now, this is something that I can do with every object in Figma. So I can literally move these around. Now, as you can see, these are points with these handles. So basically, this is going to be a little bit different. But the main point, the main idea is still the same. I can double click any shape, and I can just move around and change the actual appearance of that specific shape. Now, another thing to consider is that when I select some of these elements, I'm going to have other points that I can change. So for example, with the circle, I can change the arc, and I can also, for example, create a radius around the circle. So this is really useful in order to create graphs or pie charts. And with the star, I can also change the amount of points that the star has over here on the right. So as you can see, this is quite useful. I can also change the inner ratio of the star element. So this is quite useful. And the same is true for the triangle, which you know, I can add more count, so this can become other shapes altogether. So I would encourage you to just start adding some of these shapes on your canvas, play around with the resizing tools, with and also these other elements, because this could be quite useful at times. So yeah, go ahead, open up Figma if you haven't opened it already, and start playing around with these elements in order to really master them. And I'll see you on the next video. In this video, we will talk about Boolean operations. Now, as you can see, we have these two separate elements. One is a circle and one is a square. And I'm going to bring the circle on top of the rectangle. So as you can see over here, I have it on top from the layer list. So keep in mind that hierarchy we talked about recently. And in order to access the Boolean operations, you're going to need to select both of these objects. And as you can see on the top menu bar, you're going to see that if you click on the arrows, you're going to access the different Boolean operations. Now, the first one is the union selection. So if you click on it, you can see that both of these shapes are being united into one single shape. The second option is the subtract selection. And basically, if we select it, you can see that the layer which was on top has been detracted from the layer on the bottom. So basically, you can see that the square now has a circle almost less. So if we continue, we can click on the intersect selection. You can see that basically this is just creating the selection between the intersect of those two specific shapes. And if we go over here again, we can see that the fourth option is the exclude selection. So basically, we're excluding the center which was intersecting the two objects. Now, there's also a fifth selection, which is the flatten selection. And this basically flattens the selection, but we still have both of these vectors. So basically, this is it when it comes to the Boolean operations. This can be really useful when you're trying to create a specific shape by using one of these operations. And yeah, you're probably not going to use it as often as other elements, but nonetheless, it's definitely something to keep in mind that you have at your disposal in your toolbox. We'll talk about how to use masks in Figma. Now, I just uploaded a new image, and you can do that by easily going on File, Place Image, using this shortcut over here, or you can simply drag and drop the image or copy and paste it with Command C or Command V, or Control C and Control V if you're using Windows. So now that we have this image, we want to just crop it so that we are going to have a specific portion of this image. And I'm going to use the rectangle tool in order to pre-select the area which we want to be cropped. Now, as you can see, we're not seeing through the rectangle. So one thing that I'm going to do is to just lower the opacity so that they can see exactly which portion we're having selected. And I'm going to turn the opacity back on. And now, in order to access the mask, we need to bring the rectangle which is on top to the bottom. And now we need to select both of these layers. And now that both are selected, you simply have to click on the very middle top icon over here, which is Use as Mask. And once you click it, you can see that now a mask has been created. Now, if you have a look on the layers panel, what happened here is that basically the bottom rectangle is being used as the base for the mask, and the top rectangle, which is the image, is still available, but it's only confined to this portion of the rectangle. And all of this is grouped into a mask group. Now, if I select the image, as you can see, I can move it around and it's still contained. So I can still individually change the image position and size as well, but it's going to be contained in that specific portion. And you can use all sorts of different shapes in order to create a mask. So it doesn't necessarily need to be a rectangle. So keep that in mind. So this is pretty much it when it comes to masks, and I'll see you in the next video. Let's talk about how to use opacity in Figma. Opacity can be really useful in all sorts of different scenarios. And basically, the way it's going to work is the following. So regardless if you have an image or any type of shape, you can see that next to the layer, we have this 100% selected. So basically, if we turn that down, you can see that the opacity is going to change. So basically, that's how it works when it comes to the opacity. And if we turn it down and we bring this text layer even beneath these two elements, we bring it above, you can see that we can now see beneath these images, although the images are on the top. And the reason being is that they are less opaque. So this is definitely something to keep in mind. And there's not only an opacity related to the layer, but we also have an opacity related to the fills and even the strokes. So something to keep in mind is that you can also change the opacity of a specific fill. So let me do an example right here. So we're going to bring the opacity of the actual layer above, so it's back to the original. Now I just selected and I just added a new fill, and this is going to be a linear. Now it's been selected by default, but just to show you what's going on over here is that we have a gradient with 100% of white at the very top. And if you go over here, we are going to have 0% of white at the very bottom. Now, let's say that here, I want this area to be less opaque by 50%. One way I can do it is to go here and drop it to 50%. However, another way that I can do it is to select the opacity of this layer, which if you note is above the green layer, and I can drop it down to 50%. And now the layer above is going to have 50% of opacity, so you can have a hint of the layer below. And we can do that also for solids. So as you can see, we can create different colors because we're essentially mixing the color 50% of this current selection with 100% of the selection below. So this is pretty much it when it comes to opacities, and I'll see you in the next video. I'll show you how you can create new shapes using the pen tool, and also how to edit them. So in order to access the pen tool, which we already previously explored in one of the previous videos, you can simply click on the top left. And as you can see, I can both create rigid lines, but I can also use these vector and more circular lines. And once I select the first point, which I created, the shape is going to automatically be united together. So essentially I can, I now have this one single shape. Now if I click on the move tool again, and I double click, I can go back to the regular view. But if I want to change the shape, for example, I can simply double click on the shape again. And as you can see, as I drag these handle points, I can edit the shape and change it and basically adjust it in order to accommodate my needs. And if I select, for example, one of these angles and I click on the bend tool over here, as you can see, now I can make this a non-angle view. And there's also the options to avoid mirroring or, you know, mirror the angle or mirror angle and the length. So this can definitely be useful. Another thing to keep in mind is that you can use the paint bucket in order to fill the inside of this specific shape. So as you can see now, we both have a fill and a stroke. And we can change, for example, the size of the stroke. We can change the color directly from here. And we can also change the inside, the fill. So definitely things to keep in mind. And this is going to be really useful, especially for creating things like icons, illustrations, and any type of vector art, really. So this is pretty much it for this video. See you in the next one. Learn about typography in Figma. Now, we have this document with two simple text, a headline and a paragraph. And I'm going to click on this text in order to explore the typography features, which you can see on the very right in this panel right here. So what's going on? The first thing is we're going to have the ability to select and see the font family that this text is appearing to. So basically, here's the font family. If I want to make the font lighter, I can simply select light. And if I want to make it more bolder or black or even italic, I can select it directly from here. Now, that being said, every font family is different. So some font families might have a bold option, some won't, some will have the italics, some won't. So this is really dependent on the font family which you choose. And by the way, if you're working on web projects, I would recommend you to check out Google Web Fonts, since those are quite strong fonts to use on the web. However, there are many other options. There are also the Adobe ones, but let's just focus on the typography for now. So if I go over here, I can see that this is the size of the text. So if I make it super big, a unit of 64, you can see how the font size is going to adapt immediately. And over here we have the line height. Now, in order to illustrate what the line height concept is all about, I'm going to select this paragraph and I'm just going to click over here and reduce the line height by 150% or something around those lines. As you can see, we currently have a different line height as we edit these values. Now, another thing that we can do is to edit the letter spacing. So if I click over here and I increase the letter spacing, you can see that the individual space between each and every letter is going to amplify or contract based on the amount that we select over here. It can also go negative. So as you can see, that's the letter spacing. We can also have the paragraph spacing, which is essentially the distance between a paragraph and the other. And over here we have some interesting options. So the first one is the auto width. Now, if I select auto width, as you can see, basically the text is going to take up as much space as it can. But if I go over and select, for example, the fixed size, and I enter a value of, let's say, 200 pixels, as you can see, the maximum amount of width is going to be 200 in this case. So this is something which can be quite useful to keep in mind as you're working with projects with a lot of typography involved. Now, these are the common options which you find also in softwares like Word or Google Docs. And this is the text line, so text line center, text line right, and I can also align to the middle or to the bottom based on the current selection area. Now, if I want to change the color, I can simply go over here and change the color. And also some other options which are advanced typography options are available here. And if I click on the type details, basically I can see that I also have one more alignment option, which is the justified. And I can also use text decoration like underline or strike through over here. I can also add a paragraph indentation if I want. So as you can see over here, an indentation has been applied. And there's also some options which might be useful at times, such as I'm just going to delete the strike through effect so that we can see it more easily. And that is the uppercase. So basically, all of the typography is going to be uppercase, the lowercase option. So we won't have any uppercase letters. And we also have title case, so basically the first letter of each and every word is going to be uppercase. And we also have small caps and forced small caps. Now, these are usually options which you're going to use sparingly. So this is not something that you're going to use all the time, but definitely something to keep in mind. We also have capital spacing and some other options, especially when it comes to numbers, like proportional uppercasing, monospace, and the proportional lowercase, all style. So this can be quite useful if you're dealing with some specific, if you want to create some specific styling when it comes to numbers. So this is it as an overview for typography. Now, I recommend you to try all of these things out since there's quite a few options, and I'll see you in the next video. In this quick video, I'm going to show you how you can convert typography in outlines. Now, let's say that, for example, you're working on a logo and you need this logo to be an outline, but at the moment is just typography, so editable text. Now, it's very easy. You simply have to right-click on with the typography element selected, And you can go on Outline Stroke, and you can also use this shortcut, which is Shift Command O. And as soon as you click on it, you can see that this has now become a shape. So if I double click on it, you can see that all of these elements are basically editable, and you can change it up and really do what you want with it, because it's now a full vector element. So this is it for this video. See you on the next one. In this video, I'll show you how you can add images in a Figma file in multiple ways. So the first way is very easy. If you have an image on your desktop or even in your downloads folder, you can simply drag and drop it directly onto the Figma file, and there you have it. Now, another way is you can go under File, Place Image, or you can use the shortcut Shift Command plus K. And basically, this is going to bring up the folders in your computer, and you can add the image directly from here. Now, another way that I can add an image is actually I can create a rectangle or any other shape. And as you can see under the fill option, if I click on this small gray color, I can see this option right here. And if I go all the way down to image, I can actually click on the image. And again, the file folders are going to appear. I can click on open, and the image is going to be applied on my shape. Now, something interesting that we can see over here is that we can also update and edit things like the exposure, the contrast, saturation, temperature, tint, highlights, and the shadows. So these are really useful if you need some quick editing of the images, and you don't maybe want to use a more sophisticated tool, or you just need a quick editing on the fly. So this is really useful, and you can have access it directly regardless of the options which you use in order to add the image onto the Figma file. You can always go here and have access to these options. You can also rotate 90 degrees, things like that. And of course, you can also change the fit. So this option is going to fit the image and maintain the proportions. This other option is going to allow you to crop the image wherever you want in this specific space you have at your disposal. The fourth one is going to tile the image. So you can also choose the percentage over here of the tiling. And of course, you can always change it around according to your specific needs. So this is it when it comes to adding images and editing them. And I'll see you in the next video. We'll go through the styling options in Figma. Now, as a first thing, let's create a rectangle over here. And as you can see on the very right, we have the fill box. Now we're going to click on it. And as you can see, the very most basic option that we have over here is a solid color. So I can go through the color wheel and I can change the color hue, the luminosity, saturation, opacity, and things like that. Now, the great thing about Figma is that we also have other options like linear. So as you can see, I now have this line on the document, and this is basically, if I click and I drag this handle point, you can see that I can change the direction in which the two colors are interacting with. And if you want to change this specific color, I could go ahead over here and make it green. Then I'm going to select the second one. And as you can see, at the moment, I have a zero opacity. That's why I am only having a hint of the color. But if I move it all the way up to 100%, I can see the full color, and I can change that one as well. Now, if I click on a radial, you can see that now we're having a color in this radial fashion. So if I click again and I move these handlebars, you can see that I can edit this radial effect. And this can be really useful for creating some soft gradients in websites or UI elements. And there's a lot of applications really also in illustration. Then there's also the angular, which it's not one of the most used effects for sure, but there's definitely opportunities where this might come in handy. And the one before the last one is the diamond. So as you can see, we're going to have this diamond effect. And the very last one is the images. So this is something that we're already covering in another video, but basically if you click over here, you can select the actual image that you want, and you can add it directly from here. And of course you can also change all of the image settings directly here, and so it's kind of like a small editor built into Figma. And of course there's the blending options, so these would need a separate video, but basically you can if you're a Photoshop user, you're going to have already some experience with this. Other than that, we're going to cover this in a separate video, as as there's multiple variables involved. So this is pretty much it when it comes to these topic, and I'll see you in the next video. We're going to briefly go through the blending modes available in Figma. Now, if you're a Photoshop user, you're already familiar with blending modes, but basically they are effects that can be applied on a layer, usually on top of, in order to create a specific visual effect. Now, I invite you to create a small project where basically you have an image in the background and you have a colored fill object on the top. And you can go over here on the layers panel, and you can see that here we have the various blending modes. So you can go one by one and see, for example, that if I apply a darken blending mode, the layer below is going to appear with this more dark appearance. Now, if I go and use color burn, you can see that this is going to be to affect also the layer below. While if you go with the lightened ones, the layer below is going to be more to have more luminosity. And each and every one of these blending modes have some math behind it. You don't really have to worry about it too much. Some of them are pretty straightforward. You can kind of like hint the reason why it's called this way due to the name, but other ones are a little bit more tricky. But nonetheless, it's all about trying. When it comes to blending modes, it's all about just going ahead and try applying them. You can also apply them directly from here. So if you have an image or a gradient, or any of these options right here, you can still apply the blending modes, and this can be really useful in order to achieve some specific visual appearances and visual results. So this is pretty much it when it comes to blending modes. Feel free to experiment with these and try them out, and I'll see you in the next video. We'll talk about components and why they're so useful in Figma. Now, first of all, let's start by talking about why would you use components in the first place? Well, components are essentially reusable elements which you can use multiple times throughout the project and maintain a level of consistency and also efficiency in adding them and managing them fast. So let's take an example of the Figma website. As you can see at the very top, we have this header with this logo, the menu items, and the sign up button. Now, most chances are that they're going to use this header on multiple pages throughout the website. So if we're creating the design in Figma, a very efficient way to actually manage this element over here is to create a component. And the reason being is that if we have, for example, a website with 10 pages and we're using the same header over and over again. Well, components essentially can help you make it more flexible and easy to manage, because you can, for example, move the logo at the very right or at the center, and all of the components in each and every one of those pages are going to update immediately, and you just need to do the change once. So this is really useful, and also elements like footers are really useful to have as components, as well as buttons and many more. Now that we have an understanding of the components from a basic overview perspective, let's hop ahead and create one. So the very first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to create a rectangle over here, and I'm going to apply a little bit of radius on the borders. Now I'm going to make this a blue color, and I'm also going to add some text. So button, and let's close this icon right here, this model. So I'm going to make it, and by the way, these units are way overscaled. Usually buttons are going to be much smaller, but just for the sake of this example, I want you to understand the basic concept, and of course the ratios are going to be way smaller in an actual UI design. Now I'm going to make this bold, and now let's select both items and group them. And I'm going to do that by selecting them and then using group selection. Now, at this point, I'm going to right click on the button, and I'm going to select this option right here, which is create component. Now, another way I can create a component is by simply clicking over here, create component. And now we have created our first component. Now, if you go on the very top left, you can see that we're currently in the layers panel. However, if we move to the assets panel, you can see that now we have our first component. Now, all of the components are going to be visible from this panel. So this is going to be quite useful when managing, especially many of them. You can also toggle the list view, which can be useful. And you can also sync in with the team library. So if you're collaborating with multiple designers on a team, you can leverage one single team library and have all of the components shared so that you can work together efficiently and maintaining a high level of consistency. Now let's create a duplicate of this component. I'm gonna do that by using Command-C and Command-V. And I just duplicated it. Now I'm going to do it a few more times because I want to show you the power of using components. So let's say that I want to change this one here, which by the way is the master component. And the way you see that this is the master component is that it has this four small squares over here, while the other ones only have an outline of one single rotated square. So keep in mind that if you change the master components, all the other ones are going to follow the change. So if, for example, I go over here and I make the master component green, you can see that all of the buttons are going to change automatically. And if I change, for example, the font to Helvetica and I make it smaller, you can see that all of these changes happen in real time. So this is absolutely like amazing if you're working with a lot of screens on large projects, especially. This can help you save a lot of time, and it's definitely something to absolutely keep in mind for when creating design systems, which is something we're probably going to explore in depth in another course. But for the most part, keep in mind these components, because these are really, really useful and can help you a whole lot when designing in Figma. In this video, I'm going to show you how to export images, icons, and also group of elements like buttons. Now, let's start with the image. If I want to export this image, I simply have to select it, and on the very right, on the very bottom right, click on export on the plus, and basically you're going to see the following option. Probably the preview is going to be unchecked by default, but if you click over here on the arrow, you're going to see exactly what I'm seeing. And as you can see, the very first element which we see in the export option is this 1x. Now, what does that mean is that it's going to maintain the same ratio and the same size. So for example, this image is 1,644 pixels by 1,095 pixels. So this is going to export it exactly with this measurement. However, I can make it half, and by just selecting 0.5x, or I can make it double by simply clicking on 2x. And the same is true for these other measurements right here. Now, we also have some of this other type of measurements, which are basically saying the width is going to be 512, that's what the W stands for, and this one is the height, it's going to be 512, that's what the height stands for. I can also select it and simply change it to any number which I want, but for the time being, we're just going to keep it at 1x. And over here, I can select between PNG, JPEG, SVG, and PDF. Now, if you're not familiar with these type of file extensions, I'll just briefly go through them. Usually PNGs are great if you're having elements with transparency and you're planning on using them, for example, for the web. JPEG is usually used for flat images. This would be a great case for a JPEG export. SVGs are usually used for vector graphics and things like icons, which we're going to see in a bit. And then the PDF is pretty straightforward. It's a PDF file, so it's really good for things like reports, CVs, and any type of file which need to be exported in PDF, really. So in this case, if I click on JPEG, another thing which is important to consider is the fact that once you click on the export, you're going to pretty much export it with the same name as the layer, but you can change the name right afterwards. So we're just going to rename it to image, and I'm going to save it on my desktop. Now, as you can see in the second example, we have a button, but we're currently facing a problem, because if I select it, I can only see the background, and if I select the text and I scroll down, I can only see the text. So if I'm going to try and export these two elements, they won't be grouped together. Now, in order to solve that, it's very easy. You can simply select both of these elements, right click, click on group selection. Now, if I click on export again, you can see that I'm going to export the entire button. So again, for example, I can select this as a JPEG, not really recommended, but we're gonna do it just for this video. I'm going to save it on Scrivania, which is desktop. And the very last element which I'm going to export is this icon right here. So I'm going to click on export, and for icons, I usually like to export them in SVGs, as it's the most scalable and most friendlier file for the web, let's say. So I'm just going to rename this to Lightbulb. And if I click over here and I go to my desktop, you can see that I have the image, the button, and the light bulb selected. And of course, you can select these and add them wherever you want in your folders by simply clicking on over here, and you can do that very easily. So this is pretty much it when it comes to exports, and I'll see you in the next video.